autopsies. We've all seen them on television, but is that a really clear picture of how they're actually conducted? Hey guys, Tara here for DNews, and if you've been following the news surrounding the Michael Brown killing, then you've probably heard about the multiple autopsies that have been requested. Three so far. The first was done by the county medical examiner's office, the second one was requested by the family, and the third one was conducted by the U.S. Department of Justice. Three autopsies is a lot to perform on a single body, so why are they doing this? What's the point? Can additional autopsies really provide new information? Well, sometimes, yes, they can. This is a high-profile case, so it's understandable that multiple autopsies might be warranted. But for the most part, as long as the first one was performed correctly, there's really no need for a second or third. In fact, with each subsequent autopsy that gets performed, it actually becomes easier to misinterpret the findings because the body is already so mutilated. Now, most of what we know about autopsies comes from television, which isn't exactly an accurate picture of what goes on. So, what exactly is the process involved in conducting a thorough autopsy? There are a lot of steps involved, but in a nutshell, here's how it works. Autopsies are performed by forensic pathologists, and they're generally split into two separate procedures. There's the external examination, where they look at the outside of the body and try to find evidence of injury, disease, or anything that appears out of the ordinary. Anything on the body that's relevant to the case, like clothing, gunpowder residue, or DNA from someone else, then gets sent to a different lab for analysis, and all of this is documented with photographs. Then there's the internal examination, where they literally cut the body open, starting at the shoulders and going down to the groin. In a standard autopsy, they'll look at the organs in the chest, abdomen, and pelvis. But if other parts of the body are suspected to be involved in the person's death, like the legs or arms or even the brain, then those also get dissected. The purpose of this is to examine the patient's organs, first while they're inside the body and then again once they're removed. So after they cut through the rib cage, they remove the organs and weigh them, and that's how they point to evidence of disease. Certain illnesses will cause your organs to swell or shrink, so based on the weight of an organ, it's possible for a pathologist to see exactly what type of disease a person was suffering from and how advanced that disease was. Once they're weighed, the organ gets dissected, again, looking for evidence of anything abnormal. And when that's done, samples of each organ are collected and preserved in formaldehyde so the pathologist can examine them later under a microscope if it's deemed necessary. In some cases, entire organs are preserved, usually the brain or the heart, to be examined by a specialist later on, but less than 5% of autopsies actually require that. Samples of the patient's blood, urine, and other fluids are also collected and sent to a toxicology lab to look for evidence of drugs, alcohol, or any poisonous substances in a person's system. Typically, those samples get held for a year until they're destroyed, while organs are retained for 5 years, after which they get cremated. Anything else that's left gets put back inside the body and sent back to the funeral home, at which point the family is issued an official autopsy report as well as a certificate of death. As gruesome as the whole process is, forensic pathologists have to be very careful when they perform autopsies. They're required to make all of their incisions such that an open casket funeral can still be performed if the family wants it. Now, going back to the case of Michael Brown, three separate autopsies have already been performed. But because of the generic pattern of bullet wounds on the body, it's been difficult to draw any conclusions about what exactly happened. And unfortunately, the third autopsy may not resolve any of those questions, since the damage caused by the first two has already significantly compromised any relevant evidence. Now, I know this is a lot of information to take in, and it is an incredibly sensitive subject, but given all the publicity that's been surrounding this case, I thought it might be pertinent to explore what exactly is involved in these kinds of procedures. By the way, you may notice we did not include any actual footage of an autopsy in this episode, for obvious reasons, but if you are so inclined, there are videos of them on YouTube. Just be prepared. They are insanely gruesome, so don't say I didn't warn you. In the meantime, if you guys have any questions or anything that needs clarification, you can leave it in the comments. Otherwise, thanks for watching.